Isaac Newton withdrew his papers from publication and severed all ties with the Royal Society. Withdrawing to the seclusion of his Cambridge cloister. And there he might have stayed, his revolutionary ideas lost forever, had it not been for another young scientist. And the last of the players in our drama, the charismatic Edmund Halley.
Halley was as gregarious as Newton was solitary. He was as handsome as Hook was ugly. He smoked, drank brandy, and swore like a sea captain. He had a passion for adventure and courted women with silks and satins and clashed with pirates hunting treasure on the high seas.
He was the son of a rich soap merchant, but from an early age, he realized that his destiny lay not with soap, but in the world of science and discovery. He was fascinated by the new ideas that were opening up. Most of all, he was gripped by astronomy and the advances promised by Christopher Wren's new Royal Observatory. And he desperately wanted to be part of the action.
In 1676, when Halley was only 20 years old, he abandoned his studies at Oxford University and bet his scientific name on an adventure to the South Atlantic island of St. Helena.
It was an incredibly ambitious mission. He proposed to map the stars in the Southern Hemisphere. If Halley was successful, then the Navy could navigate better in the treacherous southern seas. But it was also a chance for him to take back important new data to the scientists of Britain. St. Helena was Halley's bid to join the big boys.
Over the course of a year, using his sextant and his telescope, Halley was able to chart the position of 341 stars accurately. He did all the observations and the calculations himself. It was a heroic job. When Halley returned to London in 1678, he was made a national hero. The Navy were thrilled with their new map of the southern skies. The Royal Society made him a fellow at the age of only about 22. And the King insisted that Oxford University give him his degree.
The young Halley quickly took his place among the scientific heavyweights of the day. Halley threw himself into the race to explain the movements of the universe.
This is the Octagon Room. It's right at the heart of the observatory. And it's in this room that Halley and his colleagues did their observations.
Their official purpose was to perfect star charts for the Navy. But it was the bigger questions about the universe that dominated their studies. Keen to share ideas about the cosmos, Halley and Wren would regularly meet with Robert Hooke in London's fashionable coffee houses.
Now imagine that this is the Sun, and this is a planet. They ask themselves, why do planets move in orbits around the Sun rather than just shooting off into space? They speculated, just as Newton had done, that there was an invisible force that the Sun attracts the planet so that instead of moving in a straight line, it's pulled around into an orbital path. But an invisible force was a bizarre, almost mystical idea. To have any kind of credibility, it needed a mathematical grounding. But however hard they tried, they couldn't come up with a mathematical proof. But then something happened that threw them all into total confusion.
Another comet had burst onto the night sky. And it behaved even more mysteriously than the last, swinging in and out of view. And at one point seeming so bright it could be seen in daylight. It threw the scientists into further confusion. The young Halley knew that there was only one person with the mathematical brilliance to solve the puzzle, but he was going to need some persuading. Almost 20 years had passed since a comet crossed the night sky. It had been a catalyst for an extraordinary new scientific movement. But now, the appearance of another comet had raised more questions still. The pioneering scientists needed help.
In the summer of 1684, Edmund Halley came here to Cambridge with a mission. He wants to track down the weird and socially dysfunctional Isaac Newton. He knew that Newton was the only person on the planet with the genius to explain the behavior of the planets and stars mathematically. But it was a bold move. Newton's reputation for being sour and unfriendly was widespread. Halley caught Newton off guard by turning up unannounced here at Trinity. He put to him their theory of the invisible force and the problem in explaining the elliptical motion of the planets.
Newton was still smarting from his spat with Robert Hooke 10 years earlier, so he initially rebuffed Halley.
He claimed casually that he'd worked out all the mathematics of the ellipse years earlier, but hadn't bothered to publish. So it took all of Halley's powers of persuasion to convince him to redo the calculations and tell the world.
Halley flattered, cajoled, and chastised Newton in turns. He even hinted that the celebrated Robert Hooke might be close to solving the riddle. Finally, Newton was spurred into action. Newton threw himself into a frenzy of activity. He devoured astronomical data collated by the Royal Society from around the world, tidal information from Asia, details of eclipses and equinoxes that medieval Arabic astronomers had made, Halley's star map from his South Atlantic trip, and data from Sir Christopher Wren's Royal Observatory.
Finally, 3 years later, Newton's great work was finished.